we're accountants that are proactive, or we're proactive accountants, and it's just become one of those eye-rolling phrases that people just use. If you say something like, you know, we're a proactive accountant that works with businesses both large and small, actually, you're not really telling anyone anything.
Welcome, everybody, to another episode of How To with Pixie and XU Magazine. I'm delighted to be joined today by Ben Stanbury. Ben, welcome.
Thank you, Jordan. Thanks for having me. It's good to be part of your Netflix for Accountants series.
No problem. So today we're going to be looking at something really interesting. We're going to be looking at how to differentiate your brand. But before we dive into that, do you want to give us a very quick intro to who you are and what you do?
Well, thanks. So my name's Ben. I run a branding agency called Prosper, and we deliver branding and brand strategy and brand identity design for accountants in the UK and abroad as well. And our services are branding, brand identity design, and website design and print design, essentially.
Okay. And today you've got for us 7 tips to share for how accountants can differentiate their brand. But before we jump into what those tips are, let's kind of go back to the almost like the beginning and the reason why we're discussing this. Like, what is the opportunity here? What is the possible challenges, or what is the opportunity for accountants when it comes to branding?
So at Prosper, we conducted some research into 500 accountants, websites and branding in London and the Southeast. And we looked at various metrics and visual cues within the way that they approach branding, and found some common trends. And it's quite obvious that with quite a lot of firms, there's a lack of sort of brand differentiation in the way that firms present themselves online. There's a lack of differentiation in the way they talk about who they serve and their positioning statements, and right down to visuals such as colours and just the way the sort of websites perform and the way they look from a design perspective. And so when we took all of this data and had a look at it all and pulled out the sort of trends, I identified like 7 sort of key areas that accountants may be able to go ahead and differentiate their brand.
So before we jump into the 7 tips, in terms of, I guess, the opportunity here, when accountants hear the word branding, they might just associate it with marketing, but actually it's a lot more than just marketing, isn't it? Because branding can help with recruitment, it can help with positioning, could probably even help with pricing to some extent. Is this something you've seen as well?
Absolutely. I think like branding, when done well, can assist with really all of those things that you've mentioned, especially employer branding for recruitment and things like that. But I think it's important to really differentiate the difference between a brand and a brand identity. And a lot of people think that your brand is just your logo, and which is just not the case. And a brand really is the feeling that you will give a prospective customer or a prospective employee about your company when they're sort of interacting with your brand touch points. So they might be looking at your website, they might be looking at the way you're coming across or the sort of information that you're putting out on social media. Your brand is to do with your tone of voice and the language that you use in social media, and also especially on your website and your positioning statement. So that could be, do you come across as sounding like a very traditional firm? Are you very, very formal? Or are you perhaps sounding quite young, dynamic, and in the way that you sound and in the way that you look? And then, so this entire feeling of perception around your brand is shaped in the first instance by the visual language that your company will use. And this visual language is basically your brand identity. So your brand identity becomes your brand and brand values made visual for someone who hasn't come across your company before, for them to basically, they get to understand what your company is about. And then the first way they can do that is through a visual language. It's the way they interpret your company visually.
Nice. Yeah, I love that. I love the idea of visual language. It's a nice way to picture it. So jumping into the actual how-to part of this, then we've got 7 tips for differentiating your brand. The first one is all about the name of the practice. Do you want to tell us some more about that?
Yeah, so in the research that we did, we saw that a real large majority of accountants would just name them their practices after the founder, which, you know, is, there's nothing wrong with that in a sense. And it could be, especially if they're like a one-man company, they're likely to do that. But I think with your company name, it's worth remembering that your name is probably one of the longest serving aspects of your brand and your brand identity. And it's also often the first thing that someone is going to recall about your company. They might recall the name. So I think it is worth considering. I mean, naming a company, regardless of sector, is a real process, and it isn't something you can do in an hour or 2 hours. It takes, you have to throw a lot of names at the wall, see what sticks, and sort of do your due diligence after that in terms of domains, copywriting, things like that. And so it's worth considering alternative approaches to naming. Perhaps consider an emotive or an evocative name, which will generate a bit more of an immediate interest in your company. And we've always found that if you have an interesting name, that can stem from interesting branding and can lead on to an interesting brand identity.
Okay. Do you have any examples of emotive names for accounting firms?
Well, if I may use an example of a Canadian firm that I've just completed branding, they were called JCCA Associates in their previous company, and they wanted to basically set up a new company and reposition themselves. And we went through many, many names, and we went through the naming process together, and they ended up with Numerity, which I think is a really lovely name, and it's suggestive and it's emotive. And so, yeah, they were happy with that, and they've received, you know, great feedback from that name as well.
So moving on from naming then to sure. To tip number two, this is all about the colours that people use in their brand. And I know in your research you identified that a lot of accounting firms tend to use the same colours.
Yes, that's absolutely right. A lot of accounting firms do use the typical blue and grey in their logo design, and also in their website colour schemes. There's nothing inherently wrong with it, but if you're sort of choosing a pretty unmemorable name with some unmemorable colour schemes and a really generalist positioning statement, then you're really, really heading down that road of not being differentiated from your peers, perhaps. So, yeah, I think it's... with your logo and with your brand identity, colour, it can play a part. There's obviously connotations with certain colours, but it pays to be brave with your branding and your identity. There's nothing wrong with doing that. And I'm seeing more and more sort of younger accountancy firms and cloud-based firms coming up now, and they're trying to just push that a little bit and just do something a little bit different. I mean, your brand identity will, as we mentioned, be developed to have an emotional resonance with your audience. And so you can steer away from the blue and grey. It's okay to do that, you know.
Yeah.
It's the same as everyone else.
Definitely. I've seen some firms, like, I guess, more or newer cloud-based firms, mm-hmm. and then you go on their websites and it's like being on a creative agency's website. It's so bright and vibrant and nice pictures, and you're like, wow, is this an accounting firm or is this an agency in a swanky part of London?
Yeah.
But straight away you get a different feeling from them. You're not kind of like, oh, this is your typical accounting firm. They come across as very, very vibrant and energetic and looking like they'll be able to please you.
Yeah, that's right. And I think by doing that as well, and obviously that comes into play, their website design as well, just by doing that is going to appeal to a younger generation of business owners, a younger generation of talent that you might be looking to attract to your firm as well. So,
okay, great. Moving on then to tip number three, this is all about positioning statement. Mm-hmm. So do you want to give us a positioning statement on what a positioning statement is, first of all?
Sure. Okay, so one of the most common phrases we see is in a positioning statement is, we're accountants that are proactive, or we're proactive accountants. And it's just become, even within the industry, I think it's one of those eye-rolling phrases that people just use. And if you say something like, you know, we're a proactive accountant that works with businesses both large and small, actually, you're not really telling anyone anything, and it's the most generalist statement you could possibly make, which when you go down this route about your positioning statement, you can start going down the argument towards niching. I'm a fan of niching, whatever business you do. I think there's a great value to it, whereas in accountancy firms, people would argue perhaps that you don't do it. I know people who argue on both sides of that fence, really. But I think it's really important just to try and be a little bit more specific about who you help beyond individuals and businesses. And so if you're particularly targeting, you know, millennial entrepreneurs, for example, which is wide enough in itself, or even if you have niched into sort of restaurants or something like that, when you really, really narrow your positioning statement and you can distill it into, say, three or four words, you then start shoehorning that into your SEO efforts, and then you will see yourself returning very, very well on search engine results pages for that specific phrase. So done well and done with thought, your positioning statement can have a really strong impact on your search engine results.
Okay. Do you have a formula or a structure for a positioning statement? I know they can vary dramatically, but is there like a kind of template formula that people could use to create their positioning statement?
Yeah, there is. I think it's very, very basic. It's we do discipline Y for market X, or discipline X for market Y. And so we do this for this type of audience. And so it's important to articulate what the X and what the Y is. And if you can actually articulate those, even one of them, so you may niche your services to a particular industry sector. So we do accounting for restaurants, for example, is one way of positioning. Or you might position in a discipline, so you do a specialist tax advice only for a wider range of businesses. But either way, it's important just to try and spell it out a little bit more than say we're proactive accountants that offer accounting services for all businesses, because it doesn't tell anyone anything, you know.
Yeah, I think it's the equivalent of saying that a product is game-changing. It's don't say it's game-changing, show me how it's game-changing and tell me why it's game-changing. Yeah. Okay, moving on then to tip number four. This is all about how to make websites more visually appealing and less cluttered.
Yeah, so we've seen, and you see it on all websites, but sometimes accountancy websites are very, very visually cluttered. There'll be 10 or 15 call to actions on the single homepage, on the homepage. The positioning statement may be a little bit small. It may not be center stage. And this actually comes down to design, like effective graphic design and effective website design, and the way you're communicating that message visually. So there is definitely room for just your website layout should be considered. It should take the customer on a journey. It should explain what it is exactly that you do, who you help, how you can help them, and then just lead them through the website, essentially. Your core message needs to come through. And really, this is where typography and design play a really, really strong role.
Okay. So for an accountant listening to this, and even for me, I work in marketing, but branding is a completely separate discipline. When hiring a design agency to build a website, what are the types of things we should be looking out for? I guess the top three things we should be looking out for to make sure that it's being designed in an effective way.
The agency should be trying to understand who your target audience is, and then they'll be working with you to sort of craft language and craft a positioning statement around that message. So they'll make sure that you're actually targeting that audience. And then they should be working with you to design page mockups of your website. And from a design perspective, they should be understand the agency should we'll obviously understand that it's important to have white space in there to let elements breathe. And then we sort of step into photography and the tone of voice in the photography. Obviously, it's another big visual element in the site. And I think essentially you can tell when a website has been designed well or designed not so well. And that isn't always the fault of it's not the fault of the accountancy firm. That actually comes down to sort of the quality of the agency that they're using. But if you're, say, an accountant, you're working with an agency and say, well, I want this call to action, I want this ebook, and I want this on this page, and I want that on there, and can you make that logo bigger, and can we make that text really small? And then it's up to the agency to actually then steer the client and say, well, from a design perspective, but the person visiting the website isn't necessarily going to know where to look. Where do you want their eye to be led to on the page? And you need to make sure that your message is coming through and is flowing through the site. So yeah, the design of the site is a massive factor, and that is down to the agency to help work with the client to make sure that design is effective.
Okay, cool. Moving on to tip number five then. This one is all about creating content for the website.
Yes. So we found that there's only about, I think, 31% of accountancy firms who would have what I would call a proper blog on their website. And so by that, I mean they were writing original, helpful content for their audience to consume. And it doesn't matter how generalist the accountancy practice was or whether they're a niche, it's just the fact that whether they're writing decent content. And so what I'd always said doesn't constitute a blog, it's just an HMRC newsfeed. Because if you take an HMR newsfeed, the first line out of that might be in your newswire, for example, on your accountancy website, and you Google that first line and put that in Google, then you're going to come up with another 10, 15, 20 accountancy firms who've got that exact same thing on their newswire. So that isn't really a blog, that's just generic sort of content that probably isn't really read that much, and there's nothing in there that's going to be really helpful and useful to the audience. So the trick here is to actually write and share content on your social media platforms that is helpful, interesting and knowledgeable. And I think that's the three key things it has to be. And when you do have a blog on your website, you should make sure that there's social sharing links on there. So then people reading them, if they find them of particular interest, can go and share them on their personal social feeds. And you should also cross-link to other service pages and, of course, other blog articles within that article itself. And your blog should always be on your website and not hosted elsewhere. And ultimately, if you write helpful content and you share it on your own business social feeds, other people will read it, and it will drive them back to your site, which is the goal, i.e. getting traffic. So
yeah, and it also helps with SEO, right? Like if you're writing useful content and people are linking back to your article, you get good backlinks for the website, which helps your rankings. You could be ranking your articles for, you know, keywords that your target market is searching for, which means they find your website again. So there's a whole host of benefits there. Yeah. Okay. Just conscious of time, moving on to the sixth tip then. This one is all about social media. So what impact does social media have on differentiating your brand?
Well, I think this really stems from having the blog. And so I think it's important, if you're going to post on social media, it's to make sure you're posting helpful, relevant content, stuff that your audience is going to find useful to read. Again, it's going to drive them back to your website. I'm not saying that every single post has to be something that link straight back to your site, but it's good to sort of have a mix of that. We do see a lot of firms, and they're just constantly posting articles from Forbes and things like that, and that's okay, especially if you're sharing really, really timely content, because then it will show that you're sort of on the ball. But you need to show up on social media, be sort of consistent with the amount of times you post, make sure that you're posting to platforms that your audience are going to be active on as well. And that's especially true if you niche. So if you do, you know, if you specialize in interior design, if you're an accountancy practice that specializes in interior design clients, then perhaps you're going to want to be on Instagram, or restaurants the same, you want to be on Instagram. But if you're doing more corporate stuff, then perhaps LinkedIn. But you know, you have to sort of understand where your audience may be. But the trick is just put helpful content on there, and most of that content will be your blogs.
Yeah, and I think as well, on the topic of like branding and brand personality, actually showing some personality on social media is like a huge thing, because a lot of, not just accountants, this applies to any business full stop, a lot of social media accounts are just very dry, boring content and social media updates, and you look at the business website and it looks so fun and exciting, and then you look at the social media content and it looks like it's been written by somebody in a gray suit on a typewriter, and you're just like, oh, where is the personality in this? You know, it's just so uninviting and uninspiring to read.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. And, you know, I talk about posting your own content, your own articles, but it is the place to show your sort of human side as well. So it is really important to put some personality out there.
Definitely. Okay. So moving on to the seventh and final tip. This is something that I know a lot of accounting firms struggle with, which is recruiting good quality staff. So tell us how branding can help to recruit good staff.
So, I mean, this comes under the remit of what's called employer branding. And so I think that the first thing you'd have to do is take a bit of a look at your website and your activity on social media and say, well, you know, do we come across as an attractive company for someone to come and join us? And would people notice us? Are we saying the right sort of things? It's a good idea to have things like a meet the team pages or work with us pages, which can talk about some of the benefits of working for your firm, what you can expect. You can talk about the culture of your firm. It's an opportunity to, I mean, I don't know if fun's the right word, but just to make your firm attractive in the eyes of potential employees. And I think you can talk about the softer factors as well, beyond just, you know, salary and days holiday. And especially in times of, you know, COVID and post-COVID, people are going to want to understand and know about flexibility and that sort of thing. So it's a really large topic, employer branding, but I think there's ways that accounting firms can sort of look inward and take an honest look and see, you know, how are we looking? Would someone want to come and work with us?
Yeah. And if people listening are looking for an example, I know Alistair Barlow, quick shout out from Flinder. He does a really, really good job at this. And I know that he actually kind of said in an interview I did with him a few months ago that focusing on branding and marketing actually really helped to fill up their recruitment pipeline, because they were sharing on things on Instagram about their brand and about the company and about their values and the ski trips they go on and the Spotify playlist they have. And because of that, they've got people literally like queuing up to work for them. Whereas other firms are kind of, you know, putting job ads out there and nothing's coming in. So there's a huge opportunity there, definitely.
Yeah, that's right. And even in the language and the tone of voice that your recruitment adverts are written in, and actually if you're using a recruitment agency, it's making sure you're selecting a recruitment agency that understands that, those challenges. But yeah, like you say, things like the Spotify playlist and, you know, photos of I don't know, your staff pets, anything that just makes it look a little bit fun, and learning a little bit more about the staff members that already work there. So
cool. Okay, so wrapping things up then, we've gone through seven tips there to differentiate your brand. In terms of a game plan, some action points for accountants to take away from this, what are the kind of top three things that accounting firms listening to this should go away and do right now if they feel like they could differentiate their brand a little bit more?
Well, if they feel that the brand isn't really that differentiated, then I think the first thing you'd need to do is take a sort of honest look at your brand identity, look at the way your website is showing up on devices. Are you using, you know, are you actually visually differentiated from the next firm along, you know, in the next town? And what is it about your website that you would expect a client to want to come to you for when they need your services? I think the positioning statement is a really, really big one. If you can be really explicit about exactly who you help and how you help, then that'll be good, because people would just understand what it is you're offering, and they don't have to sort of they're not left guessing basically between you and the next firm. And I think really, if you're going to be, I think, write blogs and get them out there on social media to help build your brand awareness, to help demonstrate your thought leadership, and ultimately that will drive people back to your website where they'll be prompted to look around the other pages as well. So I would say they're the three key things.
Cool. Three great ideas for people to take away and implement. Ben, thank you very much for joining us. It's been really helpful and interesting. If people have got any more questions for you, where's the best place for them to contact you?
They can come and visit the website, which is www.prosper-agency.com, and you can email me through there.
Great. All right. Thanks a lot for your time.
Thank you, Jordan.
Cheers.